Hi, let's talk about Horner syndrome. In this video, we're going to talk about Horner syndrome and its symptoms. Horner syndrome may be divided into three categories depending on the neurons which are affected. So Horner's may either be central or first order if neurons in the hypothalamus or connecting to the brainstem are affected. They may be preganglionic if the fibers that are connecting the lateral horns or the IML out to the sympathetic trunk are affected, even if they are ascending or descending the trunk. Or they may be postganglionic or third order if the neurons from their synapse until their targets are affected. Now, as this is a anatomy of the head and neck course, it's probably important that we note that it is the superior cervical sympathetic ganglion which serves the head. And so it's from this particular ganglion that any symptoms of Horner's would present in the scope of the anatomy that we're discussing. So whether it's central or preganglionic or postganglionic, a wide range of symptoms may be possible. Some in the case of central affecting the entire body, some in the case of preganglionic or even postganglionic affecting either the side of the head in which there's the lesion or particular parts of the head, as we'll see. So the classic trope that you hear with respect to Horner's is meiosis, ptosis, and anhidrosis. But there's actually a wider range of symptoms that can accompany Horner's. It's important to understand that Horner's is going to present typically unilaterally, so on one side of the body, and in this case, one side of the head, and ipsilaterally, which means that it's on the same side as the lesion. So unilateral and ipsilateral possible symptoms include meiosis. Meiosis is a constricting of the pupil. And what's going on here is that there are two sets of muscles which control the pupil. There are the dilator pupillae muscles and the sphincter pupillae muscles. The dilator pupillae muscles are under sympathetic control. So during a fight or flight response, the pupils dilate, whereas the sphincter pupillae are under parasympathetic control. So when the dilator pupillae muscles are taken out because the sympathetic fibers to them are denervated, that leads to unbalanced sphincter pupillae muscles. Therefore, the pupils will constrict. The next possible symptom includes ptosis, or a droopy eyelid or palpebra. And what's happening here is that there are portions of the muscles which control the patency of the palpebral fissure, which have smooth muscle components to them. And there is a near constant sympathetic stimulation to them to keep the eyes open. And when those fibers to those smooth muscle portions are denervated, then the eyelids can droop, as we can see on these photographs here. So this arrow is indicating the side in which we have some presentation of Horner's. Now, related to that, classically, we would hear the symptom enophthalmos, which means a sunken globe, but this is actually pseudo-enophthalmos because as the eyelids become droopy, as there is ptosis, this leads to the appearance of the globe of the eye being somewhat sunken. It's not actually sunken, but it seems to be. The other two possible symptoms, unilateral hyperemia or flushing of the skin. And this is the result of having denervation to the vasomotor fibers. So these would be the sympathetic fibers that are innervating the smooth muscles within the lining of the vasculature and capillary beds. When these smooth muscles are relaxed, the blood flows freely and the skin is more flushed. And then finally, unilateral anhidrosis, or a lack of sweating. Most things that are innervated by the autonomic nervous system have dual antagonistic innervation. And in the case of sweat glands or sudoriferous glands, these are strictly innervated by sympathetic fibers. And when these sympathetic fibers are denervated and these glands are therefore denervated, there is a lack of sweating on the same side of the lesion. So this is all unilateral. Again, not all of these symptoms may be present in a patient with Horner's, perhaps one or several, and the presentation, the symptomology may be highly dependent upon whether it is a central, a preganglionic, or a postganglionic type of Horner's syndrome. That leads us to our assessment question for the video, and that would be, which muscles, while fully innervated, may be unbalanced due to Horner's syndrome, thus leading to meiosis? So, is it A, ciliary muscles, B, dilator pupillae muscles, C, infrahyoid muscles, D, smooth muscle portions of palpebral muscles, or E, sphincter pupillae muscles? Well, let's see. We're talking about meiosis here. And so meiosis is a constricting of the pupil. So we can eliminate ciliary muscles because they are more used for accommodation of the lens. We can eliminate infrahyoid muscles because we're not doing anything with the hyoid bone or the thyroid cartilage. We're also not dealing with the palpebral muscles, and that leaves dilator pupillae and sphincter pupillae muscles. So dilator pupillae muscles are going to cause the pupil to dilate, so they will get larger, whereas sphincter pupillae muscles cause the pupil to constrict. So that would be dilation. This would be constriction due to sphincter pupillae. Recall that the dilator pupillae muscles are under sympathetic control, and the sphincter pupillae muscles are under parasympathetic control. So during Horner's syndrome, what happens here is that the dilator pupillae muscles are knocked out and we have unbalanced sphincter pupillae muscles, so we have a constriction. So that means that the correct answer is E, sphincter pupillae muscles. Thank you very much for your time.